My head is like a lumbar drain. My head is full of brains. My instincts are to kiss this train. I hear it coming. Your conscience says, mind how you go. Your answer still says no. The normal rules do not apply, and mine is not to reason why. Gone, gone, gone. My arms are like two shipyard cranes that may not work again. Fortunes wane, my senses sunder. A cup that cheers a cheerless heart, a path I dare not chart. I look askance, not quite the part someone has blundered. The normal rules do not apply, and my grand old scheme of things, to all the pain it brings, to all of those who pull the strings, I've been good riddance. To pass the time, to coin a phrase, I'm into a million ways, to counterfeit my salad days and split the difference. The
and welcome back to Scouse Pop. I'm here with Noel Burke, and we're talking about his Echo and the Bunnymen days. So, Noel, you're receiving all this level of exposure. You've had an album out, you're touring, and then the band split. How do you recover from that sort of exposure, and all of a sudden, you know, there's nothing going on again? What happened there?
I think it had come to an ending at probably the right time for me. I can remember when Will told me that, you know, he was knocking it on the head, I was kind of pleased, to be honest. Yeah. I've been telling him for quite a while, you know, you and Mac need to get back together again. Yeah. Because our career wasn't really going anywhere, and Mac's solo career wasn't exactly pulling up trees either. Yeah. So I thought to myself that probably the only solution for them would probably be to get back together in some kind of form. And then one day he phoned me up and he said, do you know the way you're always telling me to get back with Mac? I said, well, I think I'm going to get back with Mac. I said, well, fine, great, go for it, you know. Yeah. And I, in a way, you know, after coming back from the last tour of America, I kind of felt that it reached a kind of natural conclusion anyway, really. I knew we weren't going to get another record deal. And, you know, we could have gone, carried on touring, but I don't think it would have been to much end, really. It had kind of, as I say, it kind of reached a natural conclusion. So I was kind of happy for it to have ended you know, as amicably as it did. Yeah. It wasn't a a traumatic split. It was just kind of fizzled out.
Yeah.
To be honest, at that stage, I'd kind of thought, right, okay, I need to do something else now. I need to just clear it all out of the system and start earning a living, and that's what I did.
Yeah. Because, I mean, you said in an interview at the time with Andrew Street that the Echo and the Bunnymen project with yourself was actually doomed. Well, what did you mean by that?
Well, kind of as I said earlier on, I kind of knew it was always going to be a tricky proposition carrying on with a new singer with the same name. I kind of thought that it wouldn't be that well received by the average hipster. And because considering myself, you know, the average hipster at the time, I wouldn't have received it that well myself. So I kind of approached it with that kind of, you know, I wouldn't say a negative approach, but I kind of thought when bad things happened, it was like, well, what did you expect? Mm. So when we got dropped by Warner Brothers, it was kind of, well, we could see that coming. And when the management company didn't want to have any more to do with us, I sort of went, well, you know, that was going to happen, you know. So everything good that happened for me was a bonus, you know, and it was kind of, it was more difficult for Will and Les, I think, and because they'd known a lot of success, and, you know, to see things go the way they did was hard for them, I think. But for me, it was, I was just enjoying the ride, really, you know. I was just having fun and making the most of it, even though I knew that it was, you know, it was going to be finite. It was going to end sometime. I thought, well, make the most of it while you can. This is a once in a lifetime experience, you know.
Yeah. Do you think the record company was sensitive to the criticisms? Were they, you know, believing this, well, the negative sort of feel because you'd replace somebody who was? So
I think iconic. I got the impression from them, the distinct impression from Rob Dickens, who was the MD of Warner at the time, that they were going to give it one go to see if it took, and if it didn't, you know, they probably close the door on it pretty quickly, and that's exactly what happened. We were dropped before the album was even released in the States. So the album was released and we were dropped we were on tour, which was in Edinburgh, I think, when we got word that we'd been dropped off the label, and we were only about 4 gigs into the tour. So it was like a hot potato as soon as the reviews came out, really. It was, yeah.
I've heard stories that people had reviewed the band without actually being there. I don't know how true they were. You know, Jeff.
Yes.
Yeah.
It is true. I know for a fact, we did a gig in University of London Union, and there were about 3 bands on the bill. And we were headlining, and a guy we knew, a guy called Mick Houghton, who used to be the Bunnymen's publicist, was in the audience, and he was talking with somebody from the NME, somebody who now I think is a quite well-known DJ, but I won't mention any names.
No.
But she reviewed, you know, she stayed for the first 2 bands and then left before we came on. So at the end of the gig, he said, oh, there was a woman from the NME here, but she won't be reviewing you because she only stayed for the first 2 bands. I thought, fine. But a few days later, Julie, the review, which was scaling, appeared in the NME. And it was just, and it was saying that we played old songs from the Bunnymen back catalogue, which by that stage we weren't. We were only playing new material by that stage.
So
it was like, and then, so yeah, then you kind of know the writing's on the wall when you got that kind of attitude, really.
So, you know, you pick yourself up after that and you start writing songs again. How do you start that, you know,
very slowly.
Process again?
I don't know. I just, I'd kind of give myself a long break from it and, you know, just, started listening to music more again than I had done when I was in the band. I never really had as much time or the inclination to listen to music. And I just sort of said, right, I'm not going to play anything. I'm just going to listen to music for about 2 years. And I did that, didn't pick up a guitar, didn't write a song, and then kind of cleared my system out. And then after that couple of years, I started tentatively dipping my toe in the water again to start writing stuff. But I don't know if I ever really at that stage had a view to doing anything with it or playing it again. It was just, you know, a hobby really, you know, and I was just concentrating on earning a living and bringing up kids and the things that you do, you know.